I still hate amnesia stories. The resolution of this story did nothing to change that opinion, and you'll see why when we move on with it. Before we start off, however, I think I should mention that, yes, the Sonic Sad AM cartoon show did a plot that was kind of similar to this, with regards to its overall structure. I love that show, and maintain that it is one of the best cartoons that went unappreciated in its time, but I didn't enjoy that episode either. However, it was leagues better than the comic version, and because I love doing direct comparisons between things that have already failed on their own merits, we'll get into that later, after we finish the summation of this story proper. Props to the cover art, it does start out nice and strong, with Sonic standing over the beaten Freedom Fighters, Robotnik egging him on to finish the job. You get a real nice sense of tension from the cover, with the other Freedom Fighters clearly in pain, and Sonic actually managing to look slightly menacing in this shot. It's a dire situation that's quite well represented here, so props to that. The actual opening for the story, Saturday Night's Alright for a Fight, picks up where the previous issue left off, with Sonic confronting Rotor and Sally in their headquarters. Sally, despite knowing how bad the situation is, attempts to stall him while trying to formulate a quick plan. Sonic doesn't give her much of an opportunity for thinking, however, as he throws himself at Rotor, slamming him into a computer terminal that actually folds in on itself slightly from the impact, and then proceeds to beat the ever-loving piss out of the poor guy. Then he sets his sights on Sally, which doesn't go quite as easily as he expected it to.
I prefer to give rather than receive.
You heard it here first, fanfic writers. Sally Acorn is a total dom. Tails and Bunny hear the commotion, and while they're momentarily confused about what's going on, Tails especially being a little heartbroken to see his hero attacking someone who he considers a surrogate mother, they do immediately leap forward to assist, Bunny managing to get Sonic into a rather impressive vice pin while Tails grabs one of his arms. Sally grabs the other arm, and it looks like they have him pinned, but then he just manages to somehow tornado his way out of it. I was under the impression that Sonic wasn't able to perform such feats. Don't get me wrong, I've never thought of Sonic as weak or anything, but the fact that he was able to break out of a hold like this, while not being able to really move his upper body enough to get the torque needed for such a weird movement as that, I'm calling god modding on this one. Sally and Bunny are knocked out, and while Tails does manage to recover from the throw, Sonic just leaps into the air and slams him back down to the ground as well. And so we have Sonic standing triumphantly over all his fallen foes, while Robotnik looks on via plot convenience monitor. Look, it made sense in the last issue due to the sensor on him being able to be a first-person camera. Here, it doesn't make quite as much sense. Robotnik takes a solid page or so, summarizing everything that happened in the last issue, never mind the fact that we already got a caption box telling us that this story follows from the last issue, and then he observes that there's some sort of jammer preventing him from homing in on Sonic's exact location. And then he loses the signal. No real reason, he just suddenly loses it again. Meanwhile, back with Sonic, the lights go down and he's accosted by Antoine and the substitute Freedom Fighters. And I suppose at this point I should issue a small apology. In the Sally Mini, I mistakenly said that the substitute Freedom Fighters don't do anything of substance from their introduction until years and years later, when Ian Flynn takes over writing duties, but here they are now. But can you really blame me? These characters don't exactly leave much of an impression from their first outing, and they spend most of their appearance in this issue in silhouette. What irks me more is the fact that this could have easily just been the Freedom Fighters in place of the substitutes, with Antoine turning out the lights before they had been knocked out, and this whole fight scene would have had a lot more impact with it being an extended fight between Sonic and his best friends, surrogate brother, and potential love interest. The fight scene itself, I will admit, is rather well put together. The silhouetted look and red eyes that everyone is sporting actually makes the whole scene look a little creepy, but the action flows nicely and is rather well done. Of course, Sonic handily defeats every single one of them, even Antoine, who puts on a rather brave face despite knowing that there's no way he can win. And then Dylan gets in one last parting shot that's apparently strong enough to knock Sonic out completely. You know, not to put too fine a point on it, but why did it have to be the substitute Freedom Fighters here? This could have easily been Sonic fighting the other Freedom Fighters all the way through, and it probably would have been a stronger scene, as I've already mentioned a few paragraphs ago. Certainly it would have made the other Freedom Fighters look a bit more powerful and competent, and imagine if the knockout blow had been dealt by Tails instead. It would have thematically made a lot more sense, and as we'll see later on in this issue, Tails does bear a grudge against Sonic over his behavior in this story, memory loss or no. But anyway, now that we're done trying to fix plot details in a story that was published over 2 decades ago, let's move on to the next scene where Sonic is in a hospital bed, head damaged, completely cured of his amnesia. I need to find a table to flip. Look, I know I've touched on this before, but I think it bears repeating. Any blow to the head strong enough to actually cause memory loss would probably cause a whole lot more problems besides that. And if someone comes to you and said they were suffering from amnesia or showed signs of memory loss, I'd like to think that the worst thing you could do would be to inflict blunt force trauma on them. Sonic comes to, and of course he doesn't remember anything between when he lost and regained his memory, because goddammit, that's how people who have no idea how memory loss works think it works. They find the sensor on Sonic, and Sonic decides that since it was his fault Robotnik almost found out where Knothole was, he has to make things right. Despite him speeding off, the others somehow end up at the tunnels before him, with Tails providing aerial support up above them, watching the tanks as they roll through the forest, following the signal of the device that had been planted on Sonic. Sally's master plan is to just have them follow it right off of a cliff. And everyone forgives Sonic for being a dick to them when he lost his memory. The end. I hate this story. I hate the contrivances. I hate the conveniences. There aren't even any bright spots in this half like there was in the first one. The only good thing I can really say is that Art Mawinney's pencils are once again great, and the action scene, which makes up a majority of the story, is pretty well paced and choreographed, choice of characters notwithstanding. Now, let's take a quick look at the Sad AM episode I mentioned before. Immediately, it gets a big boost despite its premise because it isn't a blow to the head that causes Sonic's memory loss. Rather, it's some sort of experimental memory scrambler. So while it's still a BS trope, science fiction makes it a bit more bearable. Robotnik's nowhere to be seen in this episode either, off to squash an off-screen rebellion, while Snively is in charge and tries to use this to his advantage. While Sally does figure out what's going on and warns the others, Sonic takes advantage of Tails' naivete to get into the village, and Snively very nearly succeeds, where Robotnik failed, much to his delight, until the memory scrambling is reversed, again via sci-fi, and then is turned on Snively for a rather humorous ending. It's certainly not perfect and isn't one of my favorites among episodes of the series, but looking at these two stories side by side, there is no contest. The television plot actually manages to be a bit more believable and a bit more enjoyable. And overall, it is a better example of this trope, if only because it actually goes out of its way to avoid the whole blunt force trauma thing. But we're not quite done with the comic yet. We have a backup story to look at, and it's a fairly beefy one this time at 8 pages. Growing Pains, Part 1 of 2. It opens with Tails, looking a little pissed, heading away from Sonic. As I said before, he's still bearing a bit of a grudge against Sonic for beating him up. And apparently Tails is mad enough, and feels like he doesn't belong, that he wants to leave and go off on his own. A bit of a leap in logic, and given Tails' admiration for Sonic and Sally, a bit out of the blue. Not sure how I feel on this point in the long run. Tails heads over to the dock submarine, dubbed the Sea Fox, which he's been secretly making seaworthy again, and heads out on his own. Into the open ocean. With no supplies. Without telling anyone. Tails is still a kid, keep in mind. Robotnik, having observed this on a hidden camera, and yes, they do actually point it out, so it's not really a plot convenience camera this time, and decides to take down Tails first in his bid to divide and conquer the rest of the Freedom Fighters, even setting up the rest of the plot by telling us that he still has a leftover duplicate robot from the destroyed factory in the Sally miniseries. Gee, I wonder what's going to happen later in this story. I am in so much suspense right now. Tails comes across a stereotypical deserted island and hears someone calling for help. He leaps into action and is immediately smitten when he finds a young vixen tied to a tree named Fiona. Something tells me that ominous cutaway signifies some terrible foreshadowing regarding the name Fiona. Anyway, Fiona and Tails immediately fall head over heels for one another in an over-the-top romantic montage that calls for some good old royalty-free music. There's a cold wind through this Even Robotnik is disgusted by the cartoonish display, and then we learn the reason for Robotnik spoiling the twist early in the story, so they could make this joke.
Isn't it frustrating to know he's in danger and be helpless to tell him? It's what movie director Alfred Hitchcock called the MacGuffin.
Okay, first of all, MacGuffin spelled wrong. Second, would the age group for this comic really know who Hitchcock was in the early 90s? I sure as hell different, and I'm happy to note that I was a precocious little fuckwad when I was a kid. Third, no, that's not what a MacGuffin is, nor is it what Hitchcock called it. Hitchcock described a MacGuffin as the object that the plot revolves around, and the audience doesn't necessarily need to care about said object. Anyway, Fiona leads Tails to a hole in the ground and has him get into it on the premise that they're going to her house so she can freshen up. And of course, it turns out to be a blatant trap. Robotnik made Fiona specifically to appeal to Tails and made him drop his guard. And of course, now she talks like a stereotypical robot. Robotnik reveals that the entire island is a mechanical processor meant to feed Tails directly into a roboticizer. Despite his pleading and begging and attempts to appeal to her mechanical heart, this is not a story where a robot grows a soul, and so Fiona merely ignores him and does as her master commands, starting up the machine. And then we see a puff of smoke as Robotnik gives a creepy smile, and we are told it will be continued in the next issue. This backup story, despite its flimsy justification, I still don't buy that Tails would just up and leave like that despite his grudge against Sonic and despite being treated like a kid, it's pretty alright. It's rather lighthearted and silly, accentuated by Manic's exaggerated pencils and Mike Gallagher's usual silly style of writing, and it all really pops. It's fairly fast-paced as well, which I appreciate, as the story does move at a good clip, and it gives just enough of a reason to care that we want to know what's going to happen. But overall, I'm just glad to see this issue over and done with. The main story was just plain bad, and I'm glad to leave it behind. We won't get resolution for the backup story next time, however. We're going to shift gears to yet another special issue as we take a look at Sonic Triple Trouble. I'll see you all next time, everyone.
First ignited, it's like our hearts were never tired. My desires were set free, was like a raging wildfire. But now that spark has grown dark, we're now just dying embers. Afraid I'll end up all alone within these cold Decembers.
There's a fire lit, so let's unfold.